Chapter 9, Darmstadt High School, 1927 to 1928. The weekend prior to Arnie's first day of high school started most unusually. The family was eating breakfast in the dining room when Brigitte, who had now taken up permanent residence, entered the room, looking extremely agitated. There was a hasty whispered conversation between her and Bertha, which Bertie studiously ignored, whilst Arnie strained to hear the women unsuccessfully. Bertha bustled to the front door with Brigitte, and the latter soon returned. "Arnie, your mother wants you right now." Arnie reluctantly got to his feet and obediently followed her. When he got to the drawing room, a thin young man with a small, meticulous but sparse goatee beard stood talking to his mother. He was immensely tall, cadaverously thin, and white enough to qualify as a zombie drained of all blood. However, when he turned to Arnie, the boy could see how alive the young man's eyes were. His manner was like that of an ostrich. He pecked at his words, his Adam's apple bobbed sympathetically. "Hello, Arnie. Pleased to meet you. My name is Herr Rosen. I'm a journalist with the Frankfurt newspaper, and I am very pleased to make your acquaintance at last." His head appeared to bob up and down in sympathy with his words, and his throat at each breath. Arnie found it hard not to laugh. "Say hello, Arnie." "Where are your manners?" said Bertha. "Hello, Herr Rosen," he responded. "Yes, well, as I was saying, I'm an arts correspondent. Brigitte was kind enough to send me one of your smaller works, together with a letter explaining your indisposition. To be frank, I couldn't believe such a thing was possible. Your work fascinates me, and that's why I'm here." Arnie was too dumbfounded to respond coherently, so he remained silent. "Have you any other canvases that I could see?" he inquired. "What for?" was Arnie's response. "I beg your pardon," said the correspondent, nonplussed by the boy's negative reaction. "Why do you really want to see my paintings? Perhaps you want to compare me to the chimpanzees having tea at the zoo, an amusing distraction, but not to be invited into polite society. The truth is that you come here to see the freak. Isn't that the truth, Mr. Rosen?" The room was momentarily silent. But Rosen wasn't someone easily blown from his chosen course. "Certainly not. But perhaps if you let me look over all your work, I could offer some constructive criticism. I promise if I think your work is good enough, I shall review it, and say so in my column, without mention of your disability. If your work isn't yet good enough, I shall put away my typewriter until the day that you are ready. Fair enough?" Not being an entire moron, Arnie nodded his head with alacrity. The pursuant viewing was an unqualified success. Rosen loved Arnie's work almost without reservation. Brigitte suggested that Rosen be allowed to borrow three of his favourite canvases, although Arnie was loath to release them from his sight, but he was just too excited to refuse. The following Monday morning began with some excitement as Bertha dressed her son in his new, unfamiliar school uniform. He felt most uncomfortable, but when he looked in the mirror, he was pleasantly surprised by how good he looked. They went down to breakfast together and found Bertie, his head already buried in the newspaper, as usual, managed a monosyllabic grunt in reply to their chorus of "Good morning!" They all settled down to their toast and marmalade, when a roar of anger and outrage from Bertie suddenly interrupted the peace and quiet. "My God!" He jumped to his feet, upsetting his coffee in the process. Bertie held up the newspaper as if it had attacked him. "What is it that's wrong?" asked Bertha of her husband. He threw his newspaper onto the table, and then his wife picked it up, and she started to read aloud from the offending page. The heading on the arts page: "Darmstadt's crippled art protege, Anulf Hessel." She paused and looked towards her son. "Do you want me to continue?" Arnie nodded, unable to bring himself to speak. Today, I was privileged to see evidence of the remarkable artistic gifts of a handicapped 15-year-old youth in the ancient town of Darmstadt. This crippled protege, without the use of his arms since contracting polio at the age of 7, has taught himself to paint, using instead of his hands, his mouth and feet. The youth's name is Arnulf Hessel. We all need to take special notice of that name after seeing Master Hessel's wonderful and original work. Arnulf is proof that our German youth can and does overcome any adversity. I have no hesitation in calling upon our National Academy of Arts to provide Herr Hessel an exhibition so that everyone could share this sublime talent. Arnie's mother paused to smile at her son, who now had his mouth half open in astonishment. He broke his promise. He promised not to mention my handicap. Tears of self-pity were forcing their way past his long eyelashes. He hated his weakness and ran from the room, determined not to be the subject of anyone's pity. Why do you raise that boy's expectations when you know he will ultimately fail? Asked Bertie. Later, Bertha was able to reconcile Arnie to the meaning of a journalist's promise, being like ice on a very hot day, only kept if circumstances allowed. This was a lesson he always remembered. Arnie soon managed to convince himself that no one outside a small and obscure number of folk in the rarefied world of high art would ever know about Rosen's article. It helped that Arnie noticed that although the journalist hadn't kept his word, he'd praised the young man's artistic abilities to the heavens, and one place such comments wouldn't go unnoticed was the Art Academy. Feeling much better after reaching this conclusion, Arnie walked to the school. It was a golden day when the warm breath met the cold air and signaled your path like a steam train, and the cold frost in the paving stones quietly attacks the soles of the feet right through the soles of your shoes. Autumn had been sent cowering back by its more severe and pernicious big brother, winter. The shock of the newspaper article had been replaced by Arnie finding himself a schoolboy for the first time he could remember at the age of 15. Any normal boy would be rightfully nervous, but he felt a knot of sheer terror at the pit of his stomach. Would his peers realize he was normal in all respects bar one, or would they, as he dreaded, use his handicap as a weapon to beat him with? He approached the large red brick building hesitantly. He saw a group of youths and smaller children gathered in little huddles. For Arnie, they all seemed to be staring at him alone, their eyes like the turrets of 1,000 guns trained mercilessly at him. Arnie, with much relief, saw his friends Thomas and Otto in the centre of a crowd of about 10 other boys of similar age, all huddled near to the door of the building. He approached with a smile on his face, but as he did so, the group all pointedly turned their backs towards him, except for Thomas, who alone smiled at Arnie and walked the few steps between them. "Good morning and welcome," he boomed, loud enough for anyone and everyone to hear. "Good morning, Thomas, and thank you." One or two more of the group sneaked a quick look in their direction, but made no move to break ranks. "I shall always be here to stand right next to you, Arnie," Thomas said, again so that everybody could hear. The ringing of a bell by a young man with a feral face and sly smile interrupted the slight warm glow Arnie felt. "That's Ratveller," said Thomas quietly to Arnie. "We call him Rat. And watch out for him, he's head boy." The boys and girls lined up in class and entered the school in orderly ranks. Arnie was left alone, not knowing where to go. Ratveller came over to Arnie and regarded the new student scornfully. "You must be the new boy they told me about. You follow me." Rat led Arnie through a maze of innumerable corridors, past seemingly identical frosted glass panel doors. concealing their quiet classrooms. Honey was convinced that he would never be able to navigate these interminable routes without assistance. Everywhere the head boy and his charge went, they were stared at by all the other students and teachers. Arnie was trying hard not to be totally intimidated by the experience. They eventually arrived at a room which had large double doors with a sign stating, "Staff only." Ratfeller knocked politely twice and then, hearing somebody call enter, led Arnie inside. The sole occupant was Professor Epstein, his normally avuncular private tutor. Arnie didn't notice head boy Ratfeller's departure, such as his relief at finding the professor smiling in his direction. At last, another friendly face. "Welcome." He looked at the big clock standing by the wall and noticed it was now 2 minutes past the hour. He made a tutting noise, shook his head and said, "Follow me, it doesn't do to be tardy." As he led Arnie out of the staff room, he turned at the door as he opened it for him. "We'll soon settle you in." The professor led Arnie down yet more endless corridors. After what appeared to be an endless trek, they arrived at a classroom marked 4A. They entered and were met by a sea of staring, distinctly hostile faces. This wasn't Arnie's paranoia, nor, he would later discover, much to do with his handicap, but the class did appear to dislike him on sight. After all, the group had been together since they were small children, and now they felt they were being invaded by this strange and different newcomer. Arnie was very relieved to see Marlene in the class, and she smiled to him without any thoughts of hiding her pleasure at seeing him. The professor indicated an empty chair for Arnie, which he took as quickly as he could, doing everything to blend in to these strange new surroundings. A difficult achievement when you're the biggest person in the room. The professor spoke, "Good morning, class." They responded by rote, "Good morning, Herr Professor. I want to introduce a new colleague to you. Some of you no doubt already know Master Anulf Hessel. He's an unusual young man." Before Epstein could finish the thought, Otto called out from the back of the room, "Yes, only a half of him works." The professor's face turned thunderous, and Arnie noticed that although some of the class joined in the cruel laughter, many did not. Arnie couldn't understand the cruelty of a boy that he had thought of as a friend, but he was learning fast that morning of the realities of the rough and tumble of school and the mercury-like fluidity of some of the relationships found there. Arnie felt some of his naivety peeling from him like the skin from an onion. Before the oafish laughter of Otto and his group died away, Marlene turned to him. "At least his brain works." Now the class laughed at Otto rather than with him. Epstein banged his hand on the lectern. The loud noise silenced the interruptions. "Any further interruptions and the culprit will be sent to the principal for corporal punishment. Does everyone understand? Otto and Marlene?" The class settled down as the professor continued. "As I was saying, Arnulf Hessel is unusual in that he is an extremely gifted individual. His ability in all matters scholastic is, as you will soon discover, equal to or exceeds that of any of you now present. But his unique gift is to be found in the arts. His one disability, he has managed to transcend by sheer hard work, allied to a wonderful ability. It is his hard work that is a trait you could all do well to duplicate. Now, without further ado, let us proceed with today's work." It seemed to Arnie that the more he tried to become less noticeable, the more others sought to point him out. Realizing as he did that his mentors only meant well, did nothing to lessen his acute embarrassment at being so lavishly lauded for his gifts as such a paragon of scholarly virtues. that it too set him apart from the very people he would have to get along with. During the rest of his time at the school, Arnie was to discover the alternatives others held in store for him. It confirmed that he either evoked total love or total hate. Very few people were to remain neutral on the question of Arnie Hessel. But the first painful day of his schooling was not yet complete. At 11:30, the bell sounded for the morning break. This was a chance for everyone to stretch their legs, have a snack, play in the big space of grass surrounding the school. Arnie soon found himself surrounded outside by Otto and his group of friends. Unusual gifts. Is this something the old Jew spots in the crippled Jew? Otto laughed again, but hadn't seen Marlene appear close to his left. She was holding a string bag containing an apple. "That's enough, Otto," she said quietly. "I can deal with him," interjected Arnie. "What is it, Arnie? Does the big girl have to look after the little boy? What have I done to make you so angry, Otto? I thought we were friends." Otto sneered at Arnie. "Friends with you? You must be joking." Arnie felt the tears well up behind his eyes at this hurt, but he couldn't allow this emotion to be seen, as he instinctively knew that the group surrounding him would regard this as a terrible weakness. "I knew you were stupid, Otto, but a bully also?" said Marlene. He was furious at being made to look small, but convention forbade him from attacking the girl. "If you were a boy, I'd hit you for that," he snarled. "And if you were a gentleman, I think you'd know how to behave better," she replied. Otto wasn't finished. He needed to vent his anger physically. He shoved Arnie to try and force him back. But Arnie was bigger and solidly built. He stood his ground. "Think you're tough, do you?" Otto said to him loudly, as if Arnie was the aggressor. Otto started to rifle through Arnie's pockets. "What do we have here?" He took out Arnie's money, and after showing this around, theatrically put it in his own pocket. "Put that back now," Marlene told him. "Why?" he replied. "Is anyone going to stop me?" Arnie didn't know what to do, but he was nearing the point of breaking down in frustration and anger. Otto spat in his eye. The filthy muck started to dribble down Arnie's face. Without warning, Marlene swung her bag at Otto's head, smashing him on the nose with the apple at the end of the bag. There was a spontaneous burst of bright red blood as he staggered back from the impact. He was so infuriated that his natural instincts took over, and he aimed a fist in the direction of Marlene's unprotected face. Before he could hit her, Arnie threw his bulk between them, taking the blow on his shoulder. Taken by surprise, Otto wasn't ready for the well-aimed kick Arnie took at his groin. Otto sank to his knees, much to the astonishment of both him and his cronies. "How does that feel, bully boy? Put on your knees by a cripple and a girl," she said. Before he could recover, Arnie kicked him in the chin with devastating effect, sending him sprawling onto his back as some of his teeth and blood flew from his torn mouth. Two other boys grabbed Arnie from behind, and after seeing this, Marlene disappeared in the melee. Other boys helped Otto back to his feet. He surveyed Arnie with murderous intent, spat out a tooth and some blood, and slowly removed his jacket. His every move calculated to menace. He wiped his hand across his mouth and then looked at the blood on his hand and paused. "So the cripple's a tough guy, eh? Now we'll see if you can take it as well as give it." He hit Arnie as hard as he could in the stomach, and as the bigger boy doubled up in pain, he hit him again, this time in the face. He kept pounding Arnie until he thought he was going to knock him unconscious. But Arnie was determined not to give in. He kept getting back up to take more punishment. Otto's frenzy knew no bounds as Arnie's solid refusal to ask for mercy enraged him, making him feel powerless to impose his will. Now the only sounds were Arnie's sharp intake of breath when Otto hit him in the belly and the latter's exhalation of breath with the sheer effort of his blows. The other boys began to drift away. There was no joy in a massacre, and Otto's cruelty became their own if they watched. Arnie only remained on his feet due to his sheer bloody-mindedness. Thomas broke into the circle with Barleen. They interposed themselves between Otto and Arnie. "What are you doing, Otto? Have you gone crazy?" But the more powerful Otto pushed Thomas out of his path. "This is between him and me. You stay out of it or you'll get the same," Otto said to him. Two of his cronies pulled Thomas out of the way, but Marleen stood her ground. She stood, her hands on her hips, defiant, facing Otto and the rest of the boys. "So, do you want to follow beating a handicapped boy with hitting a girl? Is that how you prove how tough you are?" Otto perfunctorily pushed her aside, ignoring her jibe as he looked up into Arnie's face. "You had enough, cripple." Arnie was too weak to do anything but laugh unconvincingly. "It's been like being hit by a butterfly. I'll show you." Otto leapt on him, incoherent with rage. A whistle blew, and instantaneously Otto stopped his attack, and the rest of the crowd miraculously melted away, leaving only Arnie and Otto to face head boy Ratweller. Even though everyone had already obeyed his whistle, he blew it again, three times, until he was standing right next to the combatants, blowing it directly into their ears. "What do we have here?" he demanded of them. Neither responded. Ratweller turned his attention, so that he focused on Arnie. "You tell me what you've been up to." Arnie turned from the head boy to Otto and shook his head, refusing to answer. Ratweller continued, "Not a very impressive first day. You're clearly a disruptive element, Mr. Hessel. You'd better watch your step around here in future, or I'll see to it that you're expelled. Understood?" The small and skinny head boy had not cowered Arnie. "I'm sorry to have bled so inconveniently all over your play area, Herr Rat. I'll try not to leak in the future." Ratweller lifted his hand as if to strike Arnie, but restrained himself when Otto stepped in between them. "I wouldn't do that, Ratweller," his voice full of threat and menace. Ratweller backed off, clearly intimidated by the physical presence of Otto, whose reputation as a brawler clearly preceded him. "Cross me again, and you two will regret it," said Ratweller, before whirling away with pseudo-military precision and marching off. Otto looked at Arnie hesitantly, who took a couple of deep breaths before speaking. "Okay," said Arnie, "we're alone now. Are you ready for more, or do you surrender?" Otto's face broke into a smile, and Arnie found himself grinning stupidly. Soon both boys were laughing loudly. Otto grabbed Arnie in a bear hug of an embrace, tears of laughter now rolling down both their faces. "You're all right, you are," he said. "Even without your arms, you're twice the man that rat bastard will ever be. No one has ever put him down like that and got away with it."